Today we will be talking about the cirrhosis and one of its very important complication we know as portal hypertension. Cirrhosis and portal hypertension. So first of all, let's talk very briefly about the cirrhosis. This word has been taken from the Latin word of the cirrhus, and this word literally means that the orange or tawny surface of the liver on autopsy. When we didn't know anything about the cirrhosis and its concept, then a certain group of the people, when they died, and the people back then actually did their autopsy, they used to find a very specific liver having a color of an orange or the tawny color or the tawn color. So they used to call it the cirrhus, from where we got the word cirrhosis. Now the definition of the cirrhosis, there are two ways to define it. One way of defining the cirrhosis is it's a final outcome for a wide variety of chronic liver diseases or CLDs. So one definition of the cirrhosis is that it's a final outcome for a wide variety or different categories of the chronic liver diseases. So these chronic liver diseases, which may have different etiologies, ultimately end up in a condition which we call the cirrhosis. But there is also a histological definition of the cirrhosis. Histologically, how we define the cirrhosis? It's a diffuse hepatic process. Which is represented by fibrosis and replacement of normal liver architecture by abnormal nodules. So if we histologically define the cirrhosis, this is how it goes, that it's a diffuse hepatic process in which we see that not only there is fibrosis, but also the normal liver architecture or anatomy is replaced by the abnormally looking nodules. So what is fibrosis then? We have already discussed these in briefly in the previous discussion, but obviously here again we are going to touch it very minutely. So what is fibrosis? So the definition of the fibrosis is it's an extra deposition or excess deposition of extracellular matrix. Now, what are those components of the extracellular matrix? which then get deposited in extra or excess amount, which we call the fibrosis, which is one of the basic entities in the definition of the cirrhosis. Those components are the collagen, proteoglycans, and glycoproteins. So these are the components of the extracellular matrix which will get deposited in the excessive amount. So we call it the fibrosis, and this fibrosis is one of the components of the definition of the cirrhosis, where which we define the cirrhosis as a diffuse hepatic process, where we see not only the fibrosis but also the replacement of the normal architecture of the liver by the abnormally looking nodules. So once we have defined the cirrhosis, which we'll define every time we are going to talk about any complication. So now we turn our attention towards the portal hypertension. This is portal hypertension. Portal hypertension. So first of all, try to always read the words of the problem. Like, there are two words which combine together to form the disease: portal and hypertension. So what is portal? If I make a liver here, it seems more like a kidney. So let me redraw it. So if this is left lobe of the liver and this is the right lobe of the liver. If this is liver, then we had seen that this is spleen somewhere in the left hypochondric region. Splenic vein joins with the vein which we call the inferior mesenteric vein. Splenic vein is bringing the venous blood from the spleen, and inferior mesenteric vein or IMV is bringing the venous blood supply from the descending colon. This is a descending colon. They join with the superior mesenteric vein is bringing the venous blood from the ascending colon, and part of the rectum also goes towards this side. So they join together to form the portal vein. This is what we call the portal vein. Then this portal vein enters into the liver. Then there are sinusoids, which are a very particular type of the capillaries, fenestrated capillaries, where the nutrition-rich blood coming from the portal vein and oxygen-rich blood coming from the hepatic artery, they mix together. So this is known as the sinusoid of the liver. Sinusoids of the liver. These are a kind of a capillary which are fenestrated, and they are the place where the blood coming from the portal vein, which was formed by joining of the superior mesenteric vein with the veins coming from the splenic vein and the inferior mesenteric vein. So this portal vein enters into the liver. Then there are sinusoids, and after the sinusoids there are right, left and middle hepatic vein. They join together to make one hepatic vein, which ultimately drains into the inferior vena cava, coming from below from the abdomen. So this is the hepatic vein. This is hepatic vein, and this is portal vein. So our discussion will be regarding this vein. So there is something going on in the portal vein which is causing the problem of the portal hypertension. So we explained the first word of the portal hypertension, that is the portal word. So portal mean something regarding with the portal vein. What is hypertension? Hypertension, obviously we know from our basic knowledge of the science, said this is increase in the pressure. There is increase in certain amount of a certain pressure which designates or denotes the word hypertension. So what is that pressure? That is hepatic venous pressure gradient. So this is a very important concept before we understand the concept of the hypertension, that after the word porter, there is hepatic venous pressure gradient. So what is hepatic venous pressure gradient, or how we calculate the hepatic venous pressure gradient? We first measure wedged hepatic venous pressure. We first measure wedged hepatic venous pressure, and we deduct the free hepatic venous pressure from it. Free hepatic venous pressure. So, whenever we are to talk about the hypertension or the increased pressure in the portal system, then we are to talk about the hepatic venous pressure gradient. And this hepatic venous pressure gradient is actually calculated by deducting the free hepatic venous pressure from the wedged hepatic venous pressure. So, once we have calculated the hepatic venous pressure, then we should know what is the normal value of the hepatic venous pressure is 5 to 6 millimeter of the mercury. 5 to 6 millimeter of the mercury. And whenever the hepatic venous pressure gradient, it is more than 10 millimeter of the mercury, then we say that the patient had developed portal hypertension. Portal hypertension. And once this pressure, which we call the hepatic venous pressure gradient, is more than 12 millimeter of mercury, 12 millimeter of the mercury, then by then patient had developed esophageal varices or varices anywhere in the stomach and rectum. Let's talk about esophageal varices rather than all of these. So, but otherwise it can be any varices present in the system. So once the hepatic venous pressure gradient has exceeded 12 meter of the mercury, then patient does develop the varices, and these varices are at risk of bleeding. These varices are at risk of the bleeding. So this is how we calculate the portal, this hepatic venous pressure and its significance in these patients. So portal hypertension, these were the literal meaning of the portal hypertension. So the portal hypertension is one of the very frequent complication of the cirrhosis. A frequent complication of cirrhosis. A frequent complication of the cirrhosis is known as portal hypertension, but obviously it has got so many other causes rather than the only cause of the cirrhosis. Cirrhosis is not the only cause of the portal hypertension, but we have got so many other causes which we are going to talk about shortly. So if we are to talk about the causes of the portal hypertension, then we are to go back to the same anatomy. I'm going to draw liver once more. This is the right lobe of the liver. This is the left lobe of the liver. And here I'm going to make only the portal vein rather than making it all like inferior and superior mesenteric vein. So this is a portal vein. It's a portal vein. And here, say these are the sinusoids, which I already explained that these are the fenestrated capillaries where the nutrition-rich blood coming from the portal vein and oxygen-rich blood coming from the hepatic artery joins together. So these are the sinusoids. So then here goes the hepatic vein. This is the hepatic vein, which drains blood from the liver once it has been detoxified of the toxic elements coming from the gastrointestinal system or the portal system of the circulation. So when we are talking about the causes of the portal hypertension, then we are to divide these causes into certain categories which are based on the anatomy of these structures. For example, there are certain causes which are before these sinusoids and before the liver. So we call them, let's say these are the A category of the causes of the portal hypertension. We call them prehepatic and pre-sinusoidal. Prehepatic and pre-sinusoidal. So the category of the causes of the portal hypertension which are developing before the liver and before the sinusoid are categorized as prehepatic and pre-sinusoidal. And what are these causes? These are, number one, portal vein thrombosis. This is the portal vein. So one is the portal vein thrombosis. Portal vein thrombosis has got some causes. For example, it can be because of the sepsis and it can be because of the procoagulopathy, where patient has developed certain risk factor which make the patient very susceptible to for the development of the thrombosis in the portal vein. And lastly, in this category, it can be secondary to cirrhosis. Cirrhosis also puts the patient at a higher risk of developing thrombosis in the portal vein. So prehepatic and pre-sinusoidal causes of the portal hypertension, the first category is the portal vein thrombosis, and secondly, there can be abdominal trauma including surgery. Abdominal trauma including surgery is also a very important cause of the prehepatic, pre-sinusoidal cause of the portal hypertension, where we see either there is portal vein thrombosis here. This is the portal vein. The reason of the portal vein thrombosis can be a sepsis, procoagulopathy, or it can be secondary to the cirrhosis, or there are abdominal trauma including the surgery, which also cause this category of the cause of the portal hypertension. So once we have talked about the category A of the causes of the portal hypertension, what is category B? So the category B goes something like this. In the category B comes, this is the liver and this is sinusoid. Those causes which are happening before the sinusoids but inside the liver, we call them intrahepatic pre-sinusoidal. Before the sinusoids and inside the liver. So this category, which are we are calling the B category, are intrahepatic and pre-sinusoidal causes. Pre-sinusoidal causes. Now keep one thing in mind, that in the younger children and adolescents, we have extra hepatic portal vein causes of the portal hypertension. In the younger lads and the children and the infants, we have got causes which are before the liver. So extra hepatic causes are a major reason for the development of the portal hypertension in these category of the patients, which I'm saying that they are the young patient. So the intrahepatic and the pre-sinusoidal causes are schistosomiasis. It happens because of a parasite, and this is majority of the cases are present in the endemic areas, like Egypt is very famous for this kind of a portal hypertension, where these patients do develop schistosomiasis, and this parasite settles around somewhere here in the liver and causes the portal hypertension. Secondly, there can be congenital hepatic fibrosis. Congenital liver fibrosis are hepatic fibrosis. Some of the children are born with this kind of the extra deposition of extra excess deposition of the components of the extracellular matrix known as the collagen, proteoglycans and glycoproteins, which we call the fibrosis. Thirdly, there are certain categories of the drug which are responsible for the causation of the portal hypertension, but this is the intrahepatic and the pre-sinusoidal causes. Then there is vinyl chloride, very famous drug, chemical, which also causes this category of the portal hypertension. And lastly, it can be because of the sarcoidosis. This is a chronic phenomena which causes this problem. So, portal hypertension causes, which are before the sinusoids and within the liver, which we call the prehepatic, intrahepatic and pre-sinusoidal causes. These are schistosomiasis, especially in the endemic areas like the Egypt. Then there are congenital hepatic fibrosis. There are certain drugs which are responsible for this problem. Then vinyl chloride is a category of the chemical agent which causes the fibrosis, and sarcoidosis. So these are the kind of a problem which are become responsible for causation of the portal hypertension. Now, the category C. Category is C is the kind of a problem or the causes which are related directly with the sinusoids. These are the sinusoids. So we call them the sinusoidal causes. Sinusoidal causes of the portal hypertension. C category is the sinusoidal causes. So in the sinusoidal causes of the portal hypertension, the major one are the cirrhosis itself. Cirrhosis, which is diffuse hepatic process where we see a lot of fibrosis and replacement of the normal architecture of the liver by the abnormal nodules. Secondly, it can be because of the polycystic liver disease. Polycystic liver disease. Thirdly, it can be nodular regenerative hyperplasia. Nodular regenerative hyperplasia. And lastly, metastatic, where the mets come from somewhere else. Metastatic malignant, from any malignancy the mets get deposited in this part of the liver. So the sinusoidal causes of the portal hypertension, they happen often, here in the region of the sinusoids, which is the fenestrated capillaries, where the nutrition rich blood coming from the portal vein and oxygen rich blood coming from the hepatic artery, they mix together. So the causes which are happening in the sinusoids are known as the sinusoidal causes of the portal hypertension, and these are the cirrhosis, polycystic liver disease, nodular regenerative hyperplasia, metastatic malignant disease. So this category has got these many causes. Now let's go back to the group of a disease which causes the portal hypertension after the sinusoids but within the liver. The problem is inside the liver but after the sinusoid. We call it intrahepatic and post sinusoidal. As I already mentioned that more than 90% of the causes of the portal hypertension in the adults are the cirrhosis. But in the children and the infants, we have extrahepatic causes of the portal hypertension in these categories. Now, this is the intrahepatic post-sinusoidal. So, here the category is the venous occlusive disease. Venous occlusive disease is the most famous problem which is responsible for this category of the cause of the portal hypertension. Now, the last category of the cause of the portal hypertension is something which is outside of the liver and after the sinusoid. This category will be known as the post-hepatic. In opposition to the pre-hepatic. So, post-hepatic and post-sinusoidal. Post-hepatic and post-sinusoidal cause of the portal hypertension is the very famous Budd-Chiari syndrome. This is the Budd-Chiari syndrome. You can pronounce it maybe in a different way, but this is how we know of this disease, that Budd-Chiari syndrome is responsible for the post-hepatic and post-sinusoidal cause of the portal hypertension. Now, let's talk about the complication which are caused by the portal hypertension itself. So, what are the complications of the portal hypertension? Complications of portal hypertension. So, the complication of the portal hypertension are, number one, it can cause variceal bleeding. It can cause bleeding from the varices. Secondly, it can cause congestive gastropathy. Congestive gastropathy. Thirdly, it can cause hypersplenism. Hypersplenism or increased size of the spleen. Fourthly, the reason can also be complicated by the development of the ascites, and there can be iron deficiency anemia. Iron deficiency anemia. Then there can be renal failure. And lastly, it can be complicated by the presence of the hepatic encephalopathy. Hepatic encephalopathy. So, if we look at the complication of the portal hypertension, what we see, first I'll name these complications, then I'm going to talk a little bit about them in a minute or two. The complication of the portal hypertension can be variceal bleeding, it can be congestive gastropathy, it can be hypersplenism, it can be ascites, iron deficiency anemia, renal failure and hepatic encephalopathy. Now, variceal bleeding are because of the higher pressure in these collateral, which ultimately leads to the bleeding from these varices once the hepatic venous pressure gradient exceeds more than exceeds 12 millimeter of the mercury. Congestive gastropathy is because of the development of some sort of ulceration or erythematous punctate lesions in the stomach, where the blood can ooze and ultimately it will develop the iron deficiency anemia. You cannot actually diagnose portal hypertension without excluding the increase in the size of the spleen. Then it's the development of the ascites because of the portal hypertension. There is increase in the hydrostatic pressure and the liver can get compromised and there will be hyperalbuminemia. So increased hydrostatic pressure and decreased oncotic pressure ultimately result in the development of the ascites. Then because the hemodynamics of the patients are changed very drastically, and so the blood perfusion, blood supply to the kidneys and the perfusion of the kidney ultimately get compromised, and it results in in the failing of the function of the kidney, which we call the renal failure. Then obviously when there is a portal hypertension and blood is being shunted away from the liver and it goes to the systemic circulation, and ultimately it carries along with it the toxic elements which were supposed to be detoxified in the liver, but they end up somewhere in the brain and they cause this development of the hepatic encephalopathy, which we see that ammonia can which is produced as a result of the breakdown of the proteins in the gut, it ends up in the brain. Then there are certain free fatty acids, there are mercaptans, there are false neurotransmitter like the octapine, and there is activation of the GABA or gamma aminobutyric acid system, which is an inhibitory system of the brain. So and along with this there are certain aromatic amino acids like the tyrosine and phenylalanine, and there are certain other amino acids like valine, leucine and isoleucine. They ultimately, all of these things end up in the brain and they cause the disorientation, coma, fits and drowsiness, every kind of clinical and the personality changes and the mood changes, which we call the hepatic encephalopathy. So these are the complication of the portal hypertension. Now let's talk about the pathogenesis of the portal hypertension, how these patients actually develop portal hypertension. Pathogenesis. Pathogenesis of the portal hypertension. Patho mean pathology or the disease, genesis mean development. How we develop this disease of the portal hypertension or the problem? Going back to the same diagram, this portal vein, it is now having problem either here outside of the liver or inside the liver before the sinusoids, or inside the liver after the sinusoids, or within the sinusoid itself, or out of the liver and the sinusoids. So that all category of the problem, they lead to higher pressure being developed in the portal vein. So the flow of the blood from the portal vein across the liver, it decreases. So the pressure, portal vein pressure increases as a result of the obstruction. Portal vein pressure increases, which we had already called hepatic venous pressure gradient. So when this pressure increases in the portal vein, ultimately the blood flow decreases in the portal vein. So less and less blood flows through the liver